situation where you're encouraged to go deep can often add a lot to the opportunities for D&D people and to the complexities and challenges that come up because the faith questions can be held so strongly. When people are motivated to act, they connect with great passion and conviction and make many sacrifices. But when there are deeper disagreements, those can be quite intense as well. So today, we have one of our members, Mike Huggins, who has actually been working in his own community at some depth. And he'll be, if you will, sort of our case study. And we're going to be peer consultants with him and share his questions about what kinds of questions and processes may work best in a community and the experiences they've been having and all the unanswered questions they have. And I think this will also stimulate some of our own thinking and our own work as well. We're going to go basically in two rounds. We're keeping the questions quite open. The first round will be an opportunity for each of us to share our experiences. We're exploring the boundaries of the very question of what do we even mean by faith-based climate work, and what are some of the kinds of issues that come up. An agenda was sent out. I'm not sure how many of you have it in front of you. Let me bring this up. I think what I'm going to do is just for a few moments do a screen share with you and see if I can find what I just had up. There we go. These are the questions that I would like you to take turns, and I'll call on you to talk about we've got 40 minutes for this, and I'm going to invite you to take a couple of minutes, go into your own space, go into silence, and get in touch with your relationship to these questions. And I'll say the questions for you. What would make a conversation on climate faith-based? Have you observed, participated in, or helped make possible such conversations? What have you learned? And, or do you aspire to do any of these things? Why? What values and challenges does or might this form of climate work hold? And now I'm going to give us 2 minutes of silence. Okay. Now, how do I get back out of? Oh, there we go. Okay. Mike, I'm going to start with you. Mike Huggins.
Right. Very good. Thank you. I'll get into the description of what we're doing, but the reason that I and others are looking at this issue, looking at climate action from the perspective of faith and spiritual values, is that in our community, which is the county is about 100,000 people, we have found in our public meetings that the deeply held values that people often mention when they're talking about other issues reflect and come from some source of faith or spiritual value. So that's been a long tradition, I think, in the community. Our sense, our working group sense, is that even given that, that many faith communities and congregations are somewhat on the sidelines when it comes to the issue of action on climate change. And so we're really looking at, given the fact that people act on their values, the values that people hold are why people act publicly and sustain their work in publicly. And we think that an important source of those values in our community come from faith and spiritual traditions. And so we're trying to find a way to expand community dialogues that will draw out some of the common aspects of that faith and perhaps get into a broader conversation of what that tells us as individuals and as a community about what we should be doing on climate action.
Sharon Joy.
To be honest, I realized I missed the end of what you were saying, Mike, because I was writing on the chat. Did it show up on the chat? If it didn't, let's not go there, and I apologize. So you want to call on somebody else, Nancy, please?
I'd be happy to do that. Mike, is it Kathleen Kennett? Kathleen, if you go down in the left-hand corner, you can. There you go.
Okay. Well, I'm a religious Catholic sister, and I belong to an organization that is concerned about this issue. So you can obviously understand that it comes from a faith-based values. It's international. It's the justice, peace, and integrity of creation. So it is a global, it's a global initiative, but we work on the local level with our own sisters and our own brothers and so forth on this issue. In addition to that, I work with the Network for Peace Through Dialogue, and we have held some living room dialogue sessions on a program that we have called The Common Ground. And The Common Ground is our work to change our relationship from dominance to earth to relationship to everything that exists. And the Network for Peace is non-denominational, so it's not in a sense faith-based, but I think what your cousin said is that whenever we get together and talk to one another, it comes from something that's deep inside of you. And I think that you were asking the question before, what does it mean when we talk about faith-based? What does that mean to us? And I guess what I was trying to think about that today, and what I would say is, in what I say or do, whatever I say or do in my life, can it be verified by what I say I believe in? So it could be faith-based, but it's deep within us. So it could be based on faith. It could be religion. It could be deep values. So I guess that's what I would say at this point.
Thank you very much, Kathleen. Carol Gerlich.
Hello, everybody. This is very scary to be with such a group of seriously faith-based people. I'm here because I'm part of Sharon Joy's Connection Partners, and I met Russell, and I deeply support the efforts that are going on in Tampa Bay. However, I live in New York. But listening to you, I realize I would be inauthentic if I didn't tell you that there's a part of my life that is spent at One Spirit Learning Alliance, which is an interfaith, interspiritual seminary that ordains ministers. And in 2015, I was part of that class, and technically am Reverend Carol Gorlick, which means me. And my reason for being there is that part of the mission is to do service. And up till now, the work has really been educational. And it's been in existence for 11 years, and it's time. And listening to this, I think I've just found my niche. And perhaps it's an integration role with what you're doing to support my activism and getting this group to be, this group, One Spirit Learning Alliance, initiating, I guess, a conscious effort to do something about climate change in the middle of New York City. There are many, many disparate groups. But it seems to me that a faith-based integration possibility is very exciting. So that's my answer. I haven't done anything, but this gives me a jump-off point.
Got me excited just hearing about it. Thank you. Jim Weber.
Can you hear me now?
Yes, we can. Thank you.
So, in terms of faith-based, we at our little Unitarian Universalist Church in Exeter first bumped into Tucker and Grimm's work, Ecology and Religion, prior to its publication as a book. And we also were imbued with discussions about the duties of a liberal religion. And we were intrigued by Thomas Berry and his book, Christian Future and the Fate of the Earth. But it wasn't until we stumbled onto Joanna Macy that we really got going. And we are now organizing a month of April to entitled Active Hope in a Messy World, and that will be our banner, and it'll be the umbrella for many activities, seminars, and so on. Thank you
again. I'm really moved.
Hi, it's Maisha.
Yeah. Welcome.
Thank you. I have been a part of Network for Peace through Dialogue, which Kathleen is also a part of. And there we do the Living Room Dialogues, where we have a lot of people from our community. I'll sometimes have my friends come over, and it's like a family gathering now. It's really nice. We sit and we talk about different topics. Recently, we've been talking about the Laudato Si by the Pope, and discussing a lot of the concepts that he was talking about. And on top of that, personally, I really do, I feel like what makes a conversation faith-based, it's not necessarily just religious. If someone just has this kind of spiritual, deep, they just feel this connection to Earth, I think that makes it faith-based as well. For example, I grew up in a Muslim family, and when I grew up, we never really talked about how we were connected to Earth according, you know, when it's connected to Islam. We just said how beautiful it is, and we never really thought about it. But once you connect those two together, I think that makes it really beautiful. And if you always just look at it from a scientific view, yes, you get a lot of facts. That makes it very scary. But once you put like positivity and your spirituality, I think that what kind of creates a ground for a lot of people, especially me. So yeah.
Thank you. Marty.
Okay, welcome everybody. I am Marty Roach. I'm in the San Francisco Bay Area in a small town in Contra Costa County. And wearing my Citizens Climate Lobby hat, and with a focus both because of my work in facilitation and because of my work with Citizens Climate Lobby, my focus has really been on citizen engagement and raising political will around climate change. And so I came at approaching the faith community from a community organizing perspective. It really wasn't so much based in the values of it as based in seeing congregations and the faith community in my county as a vibrant community that had moral authority and that had community. And that seemed like a good place to have climate conversations. So I approached the local interfaith council in our county and discovered there that the executive director, who was also a pastor, was passionate on this issue. He'd actually done his PhD around climate change issues. So we became co-conspirators and launched the Interfaith Climate Action Network of Contra Costa County. And it's been quite a learning experience. It's almost a year old. We launched a big event last Earth Day, and the first learning that we had was there was no place to attract people who care about this issue in our county. So our launch event didn't just bring people from congregations and faith people. It brought anybody out of the woodwork that heard about this event that was doing anything on climate or sustainability. They wanted to connect with other people in the county that were doing this work. So that really showed to me the need we have to find community and connect on this issue for support. Since then, we've really struggled, this is my opinion, in kind of who are we and what is our role? You know, are we truly a network? We put on a lot of events last year and exhausted ourselves. And because we didn't market them that well, they were great events, they were not that well attended, so we really weren't gaining any traction. We now have another big Earth Day event coming up that I think is going to be excellent, and we are promoting it a lot more. But I just want to peek at my notes because I just wanted to raise one other thing. The other thing I wanted to mention is I had a vision going into this, and again, I'm coming more as a community organizer than a person that needs to connect on faith values. But I had this vision that I wanted to reach the ordained leadership, and that somehow because they were leaders in the community, they were really, if we could be in dialogue and be working with them, that would be really healthy for the community acting on climate. And my big learning is the people in most of the congregations are the lay leaders and the social justice committees and those people. So I see head noddings, yes. So I've had to kind of rearrange my whole community organizing head, and now we're talking, you know, about maybe having some, because I still want to have conversation with ordained leadership. So is there some way to have interesting conversations with them that will meet them where they're at, but still bring the moral depth of this issue, which has certainly exploded this last year with the Pope's encyclical and then all the other religions speaking out, you know, a way to engage that level, because right now we're engaging, I'd say, the community pretty well. Enough said. Thank you.
Really interesting squares with a lot of the experience many of us have had. John.
Hello, everybody. Before I get started, I just want to see, somebody's typing a lot. Maybe it's you, Nancy. And whoever is typing, could you just please mute yourself? That way we don't have to hear that. Okay, thank you. So what would make a conversation on climate-based, faith-based? I have a long history in Seattle of dialogue, deliberation that sprang initially from a split in a church congregation. And it started my father, and now I pick up his legacy with his recent passing, to extend a lot of the insights and models and theories that were developed that sprang out of the faith-based community to a broader world. So for me, I'm saying conversation that takes place inside of a worship facility, a church, a mosque, a synagogue, for example, or in nature. It doesn't have to be in a building. But also now online, in a similar fashion as we're doing here, as we're talking and thinking about moving on to KikoChat, which has opportunities to employ open space online meeting spaces of people who are not antagonistic to religion, I guess. That's my broad definition. And specifically, I want to encourage that faith-based and science-based don't have to be mutually exclusive. And I'm hoping that people will feel that there's an opportunity to raise up the issues scientifically, but also to talk about human elements and actions of climate change from our faith, different faith perspectives. So what have I done or participated in or made possible such a conversation? I have a long history of helping to create dialogue, deliberation, feedback mechanisms that specifically target beliefs and values in small group dynamics, for example, in different church or synagogue mosques, and then to ask everybody who participates over wide geographic experience spaces to answer specific questions about the topic, and then to analyze that on the back end. So while getting people together in one big room or one big conference is really helpful, I'm much more interested in, and I can take conversations to scale over large spaces. So that's my particular focus. So I'm the founder of the National Dialogue Network, which was spun off from the National Coalition for Dialogue and Deliberation. I'm working with Linda, I'm working with Nancy on some other co-intelligent institute ideas, but I offer my insights for engaging on a large scale. Specifically, Marty, I think you had a mention about how do you include the leaders of an organization. And for me, you can specifically target them. They can meet, you know, in private, but they can also answer and respond to the same general questions and feedback that we ask of everybody. And then our analysis of those responses over time, because it's iterative, will help us to understand where different demographic groups are converging together or maybe splitting apart. So that's what I hope I can offer this group, and I'm very excited to be part of your organization and seeing Linda when she comes out here to Seattle in just a little while. Thank you very much.
Thank you, John. You've raised several interesting questions questions that I know might be of interest to Sharon Joy. So I'm going to come back to you, and I'm going to ask you if you would, as you share your own responses to these questions, if you could then move into inviting Russell and introduce him, if you would, and invite his commentary as the next person after you.
Okay, happy to. Hello, it is inspiring, isn't it? You want to take notes and follow up on so many things. For myself, based on our questions and our challenges that we've identified, one that's shown up since I became engaged in interfaith and climate is recognizing that the faith communities in some areas or in some denominations are already focused on this issue. Others are not. The larger weaving seems to me to bring the different groups together, because maybe they are still focused on self-sustaining, self-direction. So that's something I've noticed. However, it was Russell actually who made it clear to me that it is faith communities and elders who vote. So I have been very thoughtful and strategic in the last year or more holding that thought, and that's where, for me, I see no boundaries. I'm not in a particular faith group. Often people think I'm one faith or another because I show up in the congregations and I'm part of those communities and am considered one of them by the group. And then also others think I'm part of it. So I don't see boundaries. What I see are connections and networks and possibilities. I'm a student of living systems. In fact, it was in the Teilhard Association in New York City where I first met Mary Evelyn and John and Tom Berry, and had some wonderful times there. And I continue to study these sciences. As I think it was John that said, there doesn't have to be a separation between the science and the faith. I studied with Matthew Fox for a year on living systems. And since I've been in Tampa Bay, I've basically been applying. So for me, I'm fascinated with human consciousness and who we really are, and find that climate change is probably the best thing going as far as an invitation that's truly motivating. You know, it's that old pinch technique that we've talked about in some of our planning. So I think this is a very exciting opportunity. And one of the things I've seen myself do is focus, instead of on what's working, what wasn't working. Like the fact that I couldn't get as many faith groups involved as I wanted to come to our second gathering of interfaith in Florida. And I realized that the science shows us the principles of following, or let's say, what you put your attention on grows. So if we put our attention on what's broken and falling apart, it will continue to be broken and falling apart. I've tried to shift my paradigm, my thinking, my practices, and sure enough, I get caught up in the scarcity instead of the abundance. So what I've learned is to pay attention to the groups that are actually starting to coalesce. I work strategically with the Citizens Climate Lobby because I think, you know, they're right on in building relationships with your decision makers. And I just got an email from one the other day, yesterday, saying that the Presbyterians are really starting to get around this. So I want to pay attention on what's working and let go of what isn't as much. Let me see. The other thing I wanted to bring up, of what I've learned in this, is it gets a lot more fun, a lot more spicy, and a lot more leverage when you bring the whole system in the room, not just the faith. So we work with government leaders, business leaders, education leaders, students, nonprofits, grassroots. all smushed together. Just like any system, the more diversity you have, the richer it is. And hang on to your hat, but don't fasten your seatbelt, because you want to fly. Now, that I can see my friend Russell has his seatbelt on. So maybe Russell Meyer, who's my friend, conspirator, and more formally the executive director of the Florida Council of Churches, might tell us a little bit about our recent experience, although next month we're going to get, I guess, more into those details. But addressing what our questions are about, Russell, you didn't hear these. What do we mean by faith-based? And what are the issues? What would make a conversation on climate faith-based? And have you observed, participated in one of these? And what have you learned? I think that's enough to get you sparked. So let me introduce my friend Russell Meyer with his seatbelt on.
Thank you, Sharon Joy. It's good to meet you all virtually. And I've heard several of you speak. And I will be, I guess, presenting next month, so I won't say a whole lot now. I will be stationary in a few minutes, so that'll be better too. So let me just back up to this question. Thank you for sharing it. I was feeling like I was playing Jeopardy. I heard the answers. I had to guess the questions. So when we say faith-based, I think that what we're talking about is values. But often what ends up happening is organizational endeavors. And when we go to try and connect with faith communities, because we want to be faith-based, and then we focus ourselves on how do we get their organizational structure to plug into what we're doing, let me just say that's a recipe either for great frustration or outright failure. Organizations behave like people. They seek their own survival first. And so simply trying to get an organization to sign up because you think they should believe what you believe, things don't work that way. But when we talk about being faith-based, we're really talking about values. And so the question then is, how do we identify and distill the language by which we unlock the key to people's value of connectivity? And this is a question in particular that we've been addressing in the Florida Interfaith Climate Action Network over Kiko Chat, I might say. And the piece that I want to bring people back to over and over again is the unity that lies at the heart of all reality. And it doesn't matter which faith community, which religious tradition, or which spiritual practice you come from, but all of them at some point have very profound reflection around the unity that lies at the heart of all reality. And when we're talking about climate change, what we're really talking about is how our human behavior has been ignorant and sometimes downright antagonistic to that unity that lies at the heart of all things. We want to welcome every faith tradition, every religious tradition, every spiritual practice to tell us how they connect the question of climate to that underlying unity that they perceive. If if we begin with this fundamental understanding that there's an underlying unity, then we grant everybody the avenue they need to take to understand that that's true. And we don't have to say, oh, you can only drive down my street, but we can be enriched by hearing how various people get to that understanding of the underlying unity that connects all things together. And that's been disruptive by human behavior that has become ignorant and antagonistic to that idea. Now, this notion of an underlying unity is not simply a faith, religious, or spiritual understanding. Einstein had it. David Bohm had it. You find it in many, many places from many, many different people. You find it in ions and in many other traditions. So it is a place where science and religion find an affirmation of value. And so faith-based is really about asking faith communities to access where their values, understand the web of life, how they connect to that, and how they can enrich the public conversation with what they've learned about that. Now, from the organizing principle, I think it's very important and very urgent that we engage faith communities because they are the most likely voter. It'll be interesting to see what happens this year because now millennials are the largest voting bloc and they're more unaffiliated than any generation that has gone before us. And that is a particular phenomenon in the Western world. It's not a universal phenomenon. It's a Western world phenomenon that I think speaks to the disconnect that's happened around this value language of the web of life and the unity of all things. So when we go and we connect with faith communities, they are the most likely voter, and we need to be able to tap into how they understand the web of life. And people do that through, first of all, let's say their family, a grandparents, etc. The elder network is very strong that way. And then as we begin to connect that way with them, then we can begin to entice their faith leadership to get involved. I think faith leadership have two ways of getting involved. One is those who have an understanding of science and climate change and the necessity of this moment. And the other way is through civil rights. And that is that the environmental degradation has been this space that we have assigned to minorities. And there's a profound civil rights injustice that's being perpetrated because of it. There's some larger economic justice issues I talk about, but I've spoken enough for now.
Russell, thank you so much. A decision that. Are you getting an echo?
I've been dropping in and out, but I'm going to go mute now.
Okay, thank you. Good. That took care of it. One of the decisions that the host committee made was a while back was that focus of our weekly, of our monthly conversations would be on learning from each other and connecting with each other, but that on a quarterly basis, we would have a conversation that was more content driven. And we would have speakers in and provide some materials to read in advance. And March 15th will be our next conversation. And following the conversation this month, on faith-based climate work, we have invited Russell to return and give us a fuller explanation of his perspectives and the implications of that for our work. So he will be our speaker next month, and he has already forwarded a piece of a few pages length where he's talking more concretely, very precisely done work of a number of people related to this underlying consciousness question. So I'm in the process of uploading a number of resources in addition to others that you've been providing to us. They'll be available by tomorrow, so you'll have that to work with. Okay, thank you again very much. Ted, how would you feel about being our next person sharing with us?
Sure, but as long as I can introduce our program coordinator, Caitlin Cerro. And we already, can you hear us okay? We already put into the chat box a few things that we'd be happy to share to the network here. One of the reasons I asked Caitlin to join us today is because she coordinated our Faith and Sustainability Forum that we held last October. And that included preparing a PowerPoint presentation that we went out and did with four different houses of worship and engaging them with different levels of engagement in terms of preparing about what we should talk about when we convene as a forum. So let me have Caitlin add some comments from her experience, and then I'll come back with a couple observations to conclude our what we have to share.
Okay. Hi, everyone. So I guess when you were asking about what have you learned from maybe participant experience, one of the main lessons learned is that you might have someone in your congregation or in your house of worship who's very interested in connecting their feelings of faith and spirituality with climate change and moving forward with that activism, but that it's hard to get that value set to be seen by other members in your congregation. There's Russell was saying some part of this, that there's competing values, or it's hard to make it up in the hierarchy if you're trying to just survive as an institution. And so at our faith forum, we did include a track that was just about connecting this idea of climate, this problem of climate change with spirituality. And I think that was a very rich conversation because it talked more about mindfulness and the intentionality of your actions and how the motivation from your faith perspective leads into your actions as an individual and how you can combat climate change. So I think that in general, that was an interesting observation. The other point that I would bring up is that some of our conversations with congregations in here in Chicago were faith-based in their motivation of combating climate change, and some of them were just that the institution wanted to change their infrastructure or the physicality of the building, and it happened to be a faith organization. So we saw a diversity in their motivations. Maybe it was they wanted a lower energy bill at the end of the day, or maybe they were driven by their spirituality. And having both perspectives come to the table was interesting because when they came together at the forum, they were able to share both on a very fundamental, well, what can we do today, either through a program or through a connection with other people, and also the larger picture of, well, I'm hearing your interests and your value set, and how does that relate to my interests and my value set?
So the other thing I would add is we did some follow-up meetings in December with some of our plenary speakers, which was an interfaith conversation that our senior program director facilitated. Our opening speaker that I failed to mention was the Methodist bishop here in Northern Illinois, Sally Dix. She was our opening speaker. And in addition, in our Echo Justice workshop during the forum, we had somebody who is working, and some of you on the call may know this, but the Methodist Church in the U.S. is actually voting in May to divest from fossil fuels. And she was explaining their campaign, so how that was working out nationally through Methodist churches around the country. I noted in our chat contribution that we are now in the early planning stages, along with Marty Roach, who's on the call here. We had a call last week with the TOP network, and we now have the technology of participation now as an action team on climate change. And we did, Marty and I, along with a colleague from Minnesota, did a session at the TOP annual gathering. And our colleagues up in Minnesota have a much more progressive state legislature than we have here in Illinois. That's a different conversation. They have now enabled community solar. So there's a colleague organization that ICA is looking to work with up there that is not only marketing community solar to houses of worship to use for their own facility, but also promoting community solar and subscriptions to community solar as your source of power through the different congregations. So again, it plays both into the self-interest of them as a church facility, but also to their own individual. And the final thing I'll share is that in outreaching to the Muslim community here in Chicago, to have a Muslim representative at our plenary, it's also now led to conversations about how we might work with the Muslim community here in Chicago to do a Muslim faith and sustainability forum sometime later this year. And so again, we appreciate Linda's invite to ICA to join your call today and to share what we're thinking about. And as I shared, we're looking at how do we change the conversation about climate change and how we might work with colleagues like yourselves around the country come October to be engaged both in churches and congregations and in communities. And I'm complete.
Thank you so much. Elizabeth Gish, welcome.
Hi there. Thanks for having me. I'm a professor at Western Kentucky University, and I do a lot of dialogue and deliberation work with my students. And they routinely come back to questions of climate. And it's a relatively conservative area. I would say 90% of my students would openly identify as Christian, and maybe 70% would talk about very explicit religious things in class. So that's part of why I come to this. And I also work with a group of folks doing dialogue and deliberation work in religious organizations and interested in learning more about that. And I think for me, the question of what makes it a faith-based conversation is if people think it's a faith-based conversation. So if they identify it as such a thing, then it seems like it is. And sometimes it might be a faith-based conversation and that's not made explicit. I mean, my students probably wouldn't openly identify our conversations as in class as faith-based, but very often they are because their values are grounded in their experiences in mostly churches. We have a relatively significant refugee population in Bowling Green, so we do have some second-generation Muslim students from Eastern Europe, so that comes up and is interesting. And I guess the thing that I run into that's difficult is I was discussing with my students this very issue, and you know, a lot of them, when it comes to the gay marriage question, a lot of people have a gay cousin or a gay aunt or a gay friend, but nobody has, there's very few people who can make a personal connection to the problems of climate. Like they don't know anyone who lives in Bangladesh. They don't know, you know, and you can't easily identify climate disruptions as they don't make that connection that more tornadoes or more floods is related to this. So just finding ways to make it personal and to make it not overwhelming, I think. Maisha, I hope that's the correct pronunciation. Spoke about wanting to be hopeful, and then we talked about the tension between science and faith, and you don't want to be unrealistic, but you also don't want to depress people. And so finding a space in between all those are some of the things that I work with in my faith. And I should note that I'm a Disciples of Christ minister, and my doctorate's in religion. So I come from it from all kinds of different angles. So thanks so much for having me and letting me be a part of this. It's my first time.
Thank you very much, Elizabeth. Rick. Rick Wendt.
Hello, everyone. Thank you. Very interesting comments. I want to find out more about the ICA initiatives, particularly when it comes to those conversations that you're talking about. Oh, sure. My phone would ring right now. Let me get rid of that. My experience with this is through, I've worked with a number of congregations and my work as a facilitator. I believe strongly in getting the whole system in the room when you do. But to date, very few of those have dealt explicitly with climate change. The one place where I've had extensive involvement so far has been in my own congregation, which is Unitarian Universalist. So Jim and I share a spiritual home in a way. My congregation is about 250 people. So it's a good, healthy congregation. We began a 4-year process to become a green sanctuary, which is a process within the UUA, which meant you did a lot of work on involving everyone in talking with each other about their own actions and their own beliefs regarding climate. The thing that about a Unitarian Universalist congregation that makes it a natural to involve in this kind of conversation is that one of its 7 core principles is the interconnected web of being. And so, you know, a Unitarian Universalist congregation is not a faith based on a creed. It's a faith based on a covenant, and that's one of the 7 principles of that covenant. So in one sense, you're pushing a bit on an open door. On the other hand, it contains the whole wealth of, there may be people who are still in the denial area, as well as, though rarely now, especially in New England, but all the way to those who are advocating and out there in the streets working on climate change issues. So that 3 or 4 year process was really about enabling all generations and all points of view to pick up and do things in their daily lives, began to make a change and make a difference. When we first began, we did a survey, and I would say half of the congregation said, you know, I this isn't my concern right now, kind of thing. Or you're just going to ask me to carpool when I come to church or something like that. And of course, that wasn't the point at all. So by the end, we were able to see people making choices in their daily lives, and they just reported, oh, we changed that. We bought this in this way. This is green. We've got this Girl Scout troop working in this garden doing this. We've got this. So it just spread throughout that community. It was not driven from the top, and it was not driven through one large group conversation. Right now, I'm getting involved in the Elders Climate Action Network, which is a cousin of CCL, and specifically interested in this idea of elders as being both a voting population as well as a strong voice for the future of the environment. And I'm designing a presentation. We've just begun. We've done 2 sessions so far to take a conversation to retirement homes, senior centers, and like that, to get them involved in thinking about it. And I want to take it next into faith-based communities. So we're sort of beginning that. So again, I'm very interested in the conversations on climate change that were just mentioned in a note a little while ago. And I'd love to begin to see how we can exchange tools and techniques and ideas in that space. So I guess that's my answer to your 3 questions. Thank you very much.
Thank you so much, Rick. Let me encourage all of you, as you are developing materials, have any kind of write-ups, if you can either put them right now, we're using a Ming space, if you're not sure where to put them, just send them to the person who sent you the email in the first place, and we'll find the right place for them. But we definitely want to be sharing that, because we are on a steep learning curve together. Sandy Chelnov, welcome.
Hi, good to be here. I've been listening intently. Let's see, to start about myself, there's a lot of wonderful connections here I'm noticing. I too am a graduate of One Spirit. I graduated in 2014 as an interfaith minister. And I actually came to One Spirit as someone who was looking to develop myself as a person, as a vehicle to be able to speak to and bring people together around values, not specifically religion, I would say, but definitely the deeper values. I come from the consciousness community. Before entering into the Interfaith Seminary, I got a master's back about 15 years ago in consciousness studies at John F. Kennedy University in California, and also did some work at IONS, and through that work became quite passionate about dialogue work and deep conversations. Right now, I am in Buffalo. I'm involved on the planning committee of a new, I don't know if I would call it an organization, but it's calls itself an Interfaith Climate Justice Community. And the issue of interfaith and what that means has come up, even though we've been in existence maybe 4 months, feeling interfaith might, there's some way that it excludes people, and questioning the word. I really appreciated what Russell was saying, and you know, really how and thinking, well, how do we really have in our time something that speaks to the affirmation of values, of deeply held values, of what binds us all together. And actually, initially, when I was writing down some thoughts, I realized what I was reaching for with wanting to create or bring interfaith into a conversation around climate change was really how to hold the bigger picture for humanity and life in general, and to explore this terrain together. Interestingly, the Interfaith Climate Justice Community has come together around action rather than kind of conversation and dialogue so far. I've been nudging things along and saying really what we can create community by coming together with action, but there's a way I feel we need to deepen community and can come together. So far I was thinking of doing something of a cafe format. A lot of this is quite new in my community. So I'm hoping that we're going to develop. And then I'm really loving being part of this network so that I can get feedback and encouragement, I would say. Also, I've become quite active in the local Unitarian Universalist church in Buffalo, and there and starting to create, for want of a better, I'm calling it a climate change ministry right now, but I'll find a better, we'll find a better name to call it. And interestingly, within the congregation, we have a new minister, and she's saying, she's reorganizing social justice. She's reorganizing a lot of stuff in the church. And as you've already heard, a Unitarian Universalist congregation is really functions from the bottom up while being guided perhaps by the minister. And in fact, a little while ago, when we had a pledge that was being put forth by the Interfaith Climate Justice Community, it was sent out to, you know, the heads of various denominations to sign up. And when I presented it to the minister at my church, he said, "We don't really have a ministry happening on climate change, so I don't think it's worth much for me to sign this pledge. So what we need to do is create the ministry, and in order to have a ministry within the congregation, you need a minimum of five people to form a team, and then to come with a plan and work with a minister on a plan." So that's what I'm in the process of doing right now. And about, just to add about science and faith kind of coming together, I'm going to be doing a talk at the church on Thursday night. And about, because I attended the climate conference in Paris, so it'll be focused around that. And I thought, well, this is going to be church. How am I going to do this differently than I did elsewhere in the community? And what came up for me was to show the 10-minute video of message from astronauts to the negotiators at the Paris conference, because it's so beautifully kind of, it's clearly in many ways faith-based or value-based. But here are these people who are steeped in science presenting this. So that's kind of, I'll stop there. Thanks.
Nancy, are you, you're on mute.
Well, you can't hear me typing anyhow. I was sitting here watching Leanne, wondering why she wasn't unmuting after I just welcomed her to talk. I kept looking at it, and I kept thinking, Leanne, unmute.
Okay. All right.
I was the one that was muted.
All right. Are you able to hear me? Okay, good. First of all, I want to thank Nancy and Linda for the opportunity to participate. We are all fulfilling a dream that several of us had several years ago to bring D&D people together to talk about climate and to, in my hopefulness, to find ways that we can learn more about what's going on in the world of climate activity and policy, which is my world for my day job, but also come up with ways to bridge the assumed gap. And I think someone had made it really clear that there's really no gap. We just happen to see different facets of work as being non-unitary. So all the stuff is co-arising at the same time. What I've been asked to do, and I'm going to try to do it as quickly but as politely as possible, is to give you some highlights about recent activity within the Buddhist community. I will try to also respond to the question. So what we mean by faith-based, I think, is again the values, intentional choice of values, conversations, and basis for dialogue and deliberation. I think that's what makes it faith-based. I've done a lot of panels on religion and environment, and some of them at the University of Virginia, their program in the Institute for Environmental Negotiation. And luckily one day we had people who were atheists and non-believers in the room, in addition to the woman who was to my left, who was a Muslim medical doctor. And she chided us for assuming people who had connections to established or organized religions did not have deep spiritual concerns about the state of the environment, specifically about climate change. So how I got here is an intersection of three different things. My godmother was an opera singing science teacher who had most of our fun. We did most of our fun outdoors. We grew our own mints. We made mint tea, mint ice cream. We had a good time. I was active in civil rights. I worked in public and commercial television. Some of those people brought me to EPA 28 years ago. So at this time, I'm working in the Office of Policy on Climate Change Adaptation. And we are, in addition to working for implementing EPA climate policy, we're also working across the agencies in a series of interagency work groups. Some of them are international, some of them are specifically based on data collection, but the one that I'm involved in is very deeply dependent on D&D methodology, and that's our community of practice. So senior staff level people who get to do all the work, they don't necessarily have all the political fun. And in building that community, what we're hoping is that we can make more effective use of what's available in terms of scarce resources, and also enable agencies who may not see their role as working on a site-specific basis with communities to actually consider, based on the fundamental principles of D&D, who their stakeholders are and how, in fact, they're going to fulfill their respective missions. I actually wrote a bunch of this stuff and sent it to Nancy, so I'm not going to bore you with all the details, but Nancy is the person who enabled me to complete my formal education because I dropped out to hang out on picket lines and eventually vowed, yes, John, and eventually vowed to get formal education before I turned 65, which is a couple of years ago. So thank you, Dr. Nancy. I have been a board member for both NCDD and IAP2. And what I want to talk about is how the evolution of the community that I practice with, which is the Soka Gakkai International, the SGI USA, these are folks that chant Nam-myoho Renge-kyo, how we have come along this pathway over the last 30, 40 years in terms of environmental work and where we stand right now and how we are connecting to both other faith-based and secular organizations. So if you bear with me, I'm going to try to cover a lot of turf in a relatively short time. Is there anybody on this call who's not familiar with the Brundtland Commission report from 1987? If so, could you raise your hand? Okay, so we're going to make sure we post that. That is recognized, it's the document's called Our Common Future, and it's considered kind of the starting point for modern day 20th century policy, global policy discussions about sustainability and environment. And it is from the NGO responses to the Brundtland Commission report that a different document and set of activities called the Earth Charter was developed. So is anybody not familiar or heard of the Earth Charter who's on this call today? Yay, thank you so much. So I don't have to explain the Earth Charter. What our group did in the U.S. amongst those faith-based organizations, and we worked specifically in concert with the Baha'is, was to sponsor the first community-based conversations. We're talking hyper-local, 25 to 30 people in various local community centers to really talk about, so what does the Earth Charter mean within our theological context? And it was fascinating because the first one we did in Philadelphia involved having the president of the Baha'is come talk to us about Buddhism. So it was provocative, it was exciting, and on the basis of that, we have continued to work very closely with Earth Charter staff, and we have worked pretty consistently at the Parliament of the World's Religions to do our own kind of self-interested presentations and workshops, but also to do things like work with Caesar McDowell from MIT. I'll try to get all this stuff into the reference, somewhere in the reference box. But Caesar, when the parliament met in Australia, he did a series using online platforms. He was able to do conversations with several thousands of people prior to the meeting to help establish, you know, what it is you're looking for in this conversation. What do you want to get out of going to Australia? What is your group willing to commit to? Some live conversations on site and then post-meeting work. So I think this principle of full cycle conversations around heavy duty events is something we all are beginning to learn more about. So it's important for people to both build ownership of conversations, but also that we support them so that they see the value in actually participating, not just showing up and going home. The support for the Earth Charter continued in most of our major cities. We have 100 activity centers in the US, and we have members in 192 countries, about 12 million of them. And so I think in at least 10 other countries, we were supporting the so-called community summits for the Earth Charter. And those went on a combination of training, policy analysis, and advocacy. We did that here in DC for the tri-state area. So they're usually done on a regional basis. The one thing that I personally feel came out of that work was that when we opened our so-called culture center here in DC on Embassy Row, we were able to advocate through the kinds of things. I forget, there was a gentleman who talked about the difference between working with the people and working with the structure of the religious organization. So we had so much controversy around building our new center. The neighbors had put up ugly yellow signs that reminded me of World War II signs and basically declared us to be null and void. The way that we got through city council and through zoning and all of these other things was with the help of our interfaith colleagues. So it was the interfaith council that actually went to the city hall on our behalf. The reason I bring that up is that the center is quite remarkable. It's got a green roof. It's got lots of recycled materials and locally sourced plantings. And it's kind of a living example of what we talk to and with ourselves about what do we mean by you kind of green buildings, appropriate development, working in a cooperative way with our neighbors. The very recent activities that I think may be of use to this group are three things. One, we have been for 10, well, however long it's been since September 11th, we've been part of the interfaith network of the Unity Walk. So on the second Saturday of September, we open our houses of worship. And in our case, we specifically open up to talk about environment and Buddhism and climate change. So people walk, thousands of people walk up and down Massachusetts Avenue. They pop in, they check us out, they take a brochure, they go home and say, wow, look at this, Buddhism and climate change, who knew? What we're doing in, actually it's in 2 weeks, at American University here is mounting the exhibit that's called Seeds of Hope. It's an exhibit that we developed at the request of the Earth Charter staff. It talks about sustainability for people who haven't read the memo yet. And we'll be mounting that at American University February 28th through March 6th. We are hoping to bring it back for the Association for Environmental Studies and Science, also at AU in June 8th through the 11th. So there'll be thousands of people looking at this thing. It's another way that a faith-based group can have essentially an organizing role without leading with the label of the faith-based group. So the reason that Seeds of Hope is important is that it's been displayed in 27 countries and seen by over 1.5 million people. So it's one of these things that has been proven to work well in terms of bringing people concepts that they might not otherwise come across. The last and most important thing, as some of you are familiar with, is that in May of last year, the White House hosted the very first gathering of Buddhist leaders to talk about climate change and climate justice. I will not begin to bore you with how hard that was to pull together, how extraordinary it is for the Buddhist community, not just within individual sects of Buddhism and trends and orientations, but specifically for some of the big players. They began conversations several years ago amongst themselves, recognizing that the beauty of generalized Buddhist theory was nice, but that people were dying and that we needed to eventually take a stand about this. So the name of that conversation was Voices in the Square, Action in the World. And as a result of that meeting at the White House, those leaders updated what had been an earlier Buddhist declaration on climate change. So this is the most important thing, the most historic and remarkable development. What I've heard from several of you has to do with things that we need to learn about, which is the ability to essentially set aside very, very pointy ways of thinking about our particular brand and making spaces safe enough for other people that they feel comfortable, whether they, and thank you, John, whether or not they have any interest in practicing this particular pathway. I think that the opportunity, as Sharon had mentioned, Sharon Joy had mentioned about what does climate change afford us? It affords us an opportunity to change our ways. And don't get me started quoting Michael Jackson. But as we look in the mirror, as we see the change that we want to make, those of us who are privileged enough to work both in faith-based settings and also know a little bit about climate change, my boss happens to be one of the IPCC early researchers, so he's on that list with Gore and the rest of them. So I'm getting a very extreme 90-degree learning at all times every day. He reminds me the desperate need for people to really be able to have respectful conversation, but respectful conversation that is not designed for one-upsmanship, but which is held in trust for those people who come after us. So I'll stop there. And again, thank you for the opportunity to speak.
Thank you so much, Ian. And last, Jason Hudlow, would you like to join us? We cannot see you, but looking forward to hearing from you.
All right, so I'll try this without hopefully causing the whole thing to crash down. The internet isn't quite stable here. So I'm a researcher at the University of Oklahoma, and I am a fourth-year student there, and most of my work is on faith and politics more broadly. So I joined the conversation mostly interested in hearing in how you all have approached talking about climate change and faith and how that's going. And it's been a fascinating talk to listen to, and I will turn over the rest of my time.
I want to make sure that I have heard, we have heard from everyone. Is there anyone in our group? Oh, yes, Linda, of course. Hi, Linda. You're only our leader, my dear. So you don't get to speak. Linda Eleanor.
I thought you'd never ask. I'm not going to say much because everybody's...
Linda, before you say anything else, I sent you a text, but we are recording. Oh, it does say recording. I didn't see the little thing. Thank you.
Yes, thanks much to John Spady, who put in the chat box that I wasn't recording it, because that's why I didn't record last week, so I get, you know, confused. So thank you, John. We are recording. It's so cool being last because it really helps me realize so many things, and so many linkages. I really thank Russell for bringing up David Bohm. He was my guru from way back. So when you talk about what is a faith-based conversation, I just realized when he brought David Bohm into the conversation is I've been doing this for years, because Bohm Dialogue is all about surfacing all of our underlying values and beliefs and assumptions about how the world works. And suddenly I'm just realizing, well, I've been doing faith-based work for a long time, long time. The other thing I wanted to mention that I will get up either on Ning or Kiko chat is I went to the Parliament of World Religions in the fall, and I know I put a lot of stuff on the Ning about that. The one thing I didn't put up that I will, that was a fabulous way of working with values. It came from a couple who had sponsored about, I don't know, maybe 30 people to come together. They were all faith leaders from various faith traditions. in Italy for about a week, and they pulled their knowledge about trends they saw, spiritual, faith-based trends, and they came up with this, I think it's a 16-box grid that full of values, and full of values of ways the world, our culture is changing. And it's so, such a great tool. They I've tried to follow up with them, and I will again, to see if they're offering any training on how to use it. But it's a tool that I think any of us doing facilitation could use in any group, because it just simply asks people, what have you been observing about the ways things are changing out there that have to do with values, which, of course, is what we're trying to get people to do in faith community. So it might be a very useful tool, and I will get that on our digital platform. I have not done a lot of work in faith-based communities, although I just wanted to mention that I'm a former UU. I was very active in a UU congregation up in Santa Rosa, California. I was on something called the Growth Task Force, and I also started a conversational group on climate change. This goes way back, 2006, 2007. I'd completely forgotten I had done that, of course, until someone mentioned that they were a UUer. I thought, oh, yeah, I've been doing this forever. And I noticed that that was a really good place to start back in 2007, just a conversational group. Just keep it simple, because people back then, and they still are, but they were completely overwhelmed. And I didn't try to get into any organizational issue. I think people have to really come to a social recognition that this is something that they want to pursue, then they can start talking about action. So I'm totally aware of that. So I'm actually interested in what Mike is doing in his group, because he's looking for conversational guides. I know I've mentioned this a few times, but I'm trying to develop a conversational guide that will have some sort of value-based orientation to help people in neighborhoods talk about their values with respect to climate, which in some ways is a faith-based conversation. So I think as long as we're talking about values, anybody can use some of these guides that we're creating. I also wanted to just mention that I got together with a fellow locally who's involved with the U.S. Green Building Council, and they have a new program called, I think it's called Advance. And what they're doing is making their materials for LEED certification much easier for NGO organizations such as churches. And churches is one of their big, target markets. They're offering free consulting to faith-based organizations who want to green their churches up. So I just mentioned that because we're all in different locations, and you should be aware of that. Because I do think once a congregation starts talking about this, they're going to want to start taking action, and why not start greening their own operations up, as well as that gives people, individuals, some ideas of reducing their carbon footprint. And I think the last thing I want to say is I even personally having some experiences about the importance and the power of peer support that all of us need to make changes in our lives. I was at a recent Green Chamber meeting, and a fellow that I'm working with on this rate case came up to me and was talking to me about his plug-in car and how he's practically zero carbon neutral. And I'm like, whoa, so all of my stuff came up, and I started to realize, this really is how we make shifts psychologically, as we get peer support. So anyways, I'm done. This is such a big conversation. I wish we had at least, three or four more hours. So Nancy, back to you.
Thank you. Wow. This is amazing. Mike, I'm going to shift to you in a couple of minutes. I'm going to put out there, and please push back if anyone wants to. Normally, we take the last 20 minutes to do sort of general networking and invite people to say what you're up to that you want to share with the group. I'm going to suggest we not do that today so that we can take our last half hour together and follow through on the topic, what I think will be, what I hope will be the start of some ongoing work that we may opt to maybe have a second meeting this month, just as a working session for those who may want to help deal with the questions that Mike is raising, because they are so timely. I'm going to just say two things in response to all these questions. What was really hitting me, for myself, there is no way to address climate without it being faith-based. It's just too big and too scary, and I can't go anywhere near it without it triggering the need for profound faith. And I just think it's kind of interesting. Sometime in the last century, the Archbishop of Canterbury is supposed to have said, in response to a question about miracles, "I don't know about miracles. I just know that when I pray, coincidences happen. And when I don't, they don't." So would you believe that just today, on the very day of our conversation, a publication arrived in my email, apparently just published today, from someone I've never heard of. I'm not on their list, and I have no idea how it landed there. It is a new guide put together by a climate outreach in England and Green Faith, and it is a guide on engaging people of faith in climate conversation across the five major religions, and proposes language and questions that can be carry that conversation in that kind of context. Just happened to show up today. Interesting. On that note, Mike, I would like to shift and ask you to invite us to work together with the questions you're challenged by right now.
Thank you. Let me just give you a little background of what we're doing. We have an ad hoc group that we call the Eco Spirituality Working Group, because we struggled with faith issues and we didn't want to limit. And that's why we talk about faith and spiritual values. But this group formed about 3 months ago. It has two active climate scientists from the university who are also active in a Lutheran church and Unitarian church. We have the chair of the local philosophy and religious studies department. We have some community activists, two active pastors, lay leaders representing, at this point, we're just beginning with Catholic and Lutheran and Methodist, I believe, and then Unitarian. And our focus was, how do we have this broader conversation? So that's what we were trying to do, is expand the dialogue in the community. We took as a starting point to look at the encyclical. So we spent 3 half days last month going through that document, trying to digest at least some of the issues that were raised, with the idea of to what extent could that serve as some type of guide for broader community conversations. I think where we are, a couple things I would share, is that the experience itself was, you talk about faith, the experience itself was an inspirational experience. Everyone felt something that was taking place in that conversation, which often happens when you're in a group that has a fairly intense conversation. But I think the issues that are identified in that document are some of the issues we have to raise in conversations with the broader community. So one of the things we're struggling with is how to frame those questions. I've looked at a number of different discussion guides based on the encyclical, and you know, many of those go into a lot of detail, a lot of theology. I don't think that works for a broader community conversation. We're looking at a format of the study circles that Everyday Democracy has done, principally because the community has used that approach several times over the last 20 years. So there's some familiarity with that approach of a discussion guide. So I think that's the direction we're looking at. I will say too that after we've finished our discussions, I think we see at least two types of conversations coming forward. One is this study circle, small groups looking at our faith communities, which would include Muslim, Baha'i, Buddhist, Protestant, a number of Protestant congregations, and Catholic. But not people representing their congregations. So we're not really looking at official representatives, but simply people as members of the community that are coming forward with their values from faith and spirituality. I think the other thing, though, that we have to do in the community is to have that discussion, and I think, again, maybe centered around the encyclical, of the formal clergy and lay leaders. For me, it was fascinating to see the chair of the philosophy department, who is Episcopalian, and the two active pastors, the energy that came out of these discussions as they got into what Francis was saying in that document, I think is something that other religious leaders in our community need to experience. So I think we're looking at two tracks or two different types of discussions going forward. So that's kind of where we are. Looking at a study circle format, which is, maybe 5-6 discussions, typically go about 2.5-3 hours. And at the end of that, moving from talk to action and probably bringing all of the groups together for some large affirmation of what they've learned and what next steps may be for the community. That's where we are.
So, Mike, let me ask two things. The first is a short question based on our conversations. I think especially for the second group you mentioned, the theologically oriented and theological leadership in your community, which is a very large Christian component, and in the encyclical, was in particular this notion of dominion versus stewardship. And I want to just give you a chance to say a tiny bit more about that, because that was a key part of what you raised.
It was. And one of the things that struck me as we went through that conversation, and we often see it in community organizing and injustice concepts, the notion of what the dominant narrative is as we relate to issues. And I, at least in our community, I think there may be a dominant narrative from a faith perspective about what the notion of dominion means. And certainly Francis had a much different interpretation and made very strongly the point that many of the Christian perspectives had misinterpreted what that meant. And I think often that people just kind of come forward with the notion of dominion that kind of means we can do whatever we want with the world. And that was a very strong critique. I think that's a very important part of this dominant narrative that people need to re-examine. So that was one of the issues. And I haven't logged them all in. And I think there's a small group of issues that he talks about that will resonate with people as they think about what they thought they knew from faith, and then seeing that in a different light. But dominion is a very important one, I think.
So what you were asking for were a couple of things, inviting us to work almost at this point, brainstorming and acting as like peer consultants, and then possibly leading into further work on this topic among those of us interested in taking that on. Given that everyday democracy works around issues-oriented background materials that turn into living room conversations or living room dialogues, and then culminate in some kind of a community-wide meeting. Right. The fact that, as when Mike turned to them, they don't have those materials available. They don't exist yet. And he's talking to several other leaders in the field looking for that. So there may be an opportunity here first for us to support the effort in his community to create those kinds of materials or questions, but also something that may inform the work of many of us. So Mike, do you want to frame a couple of questions about questions and about process that you'd like us to, with our remaining time, we'll take a quick turn around the circle, I think, and let people throw your ideas out, and if there's any time left, we can have a little feedback. Right.
And I did talk with Martha at Everyday Democracy, and this is something she's interested in. One of the things that struck me from the conversations I've heard on this network is that this whole issue of faith and spiritual values and the imperatives for our action on climate change is something I think that we is a topic that is going to draw more and more people into. Typically, the process usually involves questions that allow people to talk about the study circles process, allow people to talk about their personal experiences. So I'm not quite sure what that is, but there's questions that allow people to share something. And I would guess it's probably sharing something from their faith or spiritual values about the issue of climate and the notion of global environmental deterioration. And then usually a couple sessions that look at either alternative viewpoints or look at a discussion of selected key issues, and then kind of wrapping up with what people are seeing with the implications for future action. That's kind of a real thumbnail sketch, but those are the type of that's the general format of what the process is. So how to do that without, you know, just diving deeply into theology, I think is one of the challenges. How do we do that without getting into very deep theological type of discussions?
Leanne, I just want to note that you had your hand up a few minutes ago, so maybe I'll pick on you to get started with this.
I'm hoping that, yeah, that may work. I'm really excited to hear about this. Could you say one more time where you're located geographically?
Sure. I Eau Claire, Wisconsin, which is about 90 miles straight east of Minneapolis.
Yes. Okay, good. There's lots of possibilities. Wisconsin is the home of one of the first religion and environment guides that Mary Evelyn Tucker and John Grimm helped us design. So it was a project done through the biodiversity, what used to be called the Biodiversity Project, and I just found Jane Elder, who was their director. It's been out of print for a while, but it's like a lot of other good work. It holds up over time. So what I'm trying to do is get a PDF of those documents, which may be helpful, and also connect you with Jane, who has been working at the intersection of environmental work and also high-level, high-quality communications between different types of groups. The two other things that I think may be helpful, and I think someone else, Linda, you may have referred to this, so for US GBRC, the EPA has Energy Star with the Department of Energy, of course, but there's a special section on Energy Star for congregations. So two different approaches that seem to be useful for people are how to save money and preserve structures of value, meaning the house of worship. How do you save your own money for at home, household scale? How do you save it on a congregational basis, so for the community of faith? And the other one is from a policy development standpoint and how frighteningly complex climate issues are, and other people may have other opinions, but this is what I've been working on, is to think about adult stage development. What does it take for a person to take on a certain level of complexity in thinking and make sure that the materials you develop are scaled for the condition of the people that they are now, not because we don't have aspirations for people to progress and for all of us to be able to take on more and do more or do better. But the reality is that in the absence of good science education, in the absence of fundamental fears about security and also about identity-based fears, like if I extend myself into this space, am I safe? Will I be judged? Will I be not taken seriously because I ask questions like, what happens to my pets under a changing climate scenario? So we've been doing a lot of work with this with our local government officials, and it's been fascinating because they tell us very specifically, we want to know about X, and we're not so concerned about Y. So once you are able from the information you're sourcing now to really draw a map of the condition and the view, the worldview of the people that you're working with, it will make it really helpful to be able to scale and shape material. So we'll find stuff for you, but you want to shape it in a way that people feel encouraged rather than so challenged, because if the challenge is too extreme, they're just going to back off and go away. But I think that those are two different approaches that I would ask you to consider, and I'm sure other people have other ideas, so I'll shut up right now. Thank you.
Thank you. Yeah.
I'm going to encourage you to signal when you have something you would like to share. And if not, I'll start around in a circle. Linda.
I just wanted to mention, I've already mentioned it, but I think, you know, we all live busy lives and we forget. When I came back from the Parliament of World Religions, I put a whole bunch of sources on the Ning site, and you'll find that under faith-based stuff. So there's a lot of, there were a lot of religious organizations, like there were, I think, two or three Catholic organizations that had extensive networks, and I think they had guides. So you might, you know, sort through that, Mike, for something. And I will get that that value grid up on the Ning site, because I think that could be a really interesting way for you to weave in a value orientation that could cut across all faith traditions in a really non, you know, conflicting way. So I just wanted to say those two things. And I also just put out on the notes that I'm aware that the National Issues Forum has just come out with another conversational guide. So that might yet be another source to look at. Thanks, Nancy.
Well, seeing no hands, I'm going to just step in for a moment. At a large church interfaith and community-wide meeting a couple of years ago, we had a superb presentation on the, I live in Santa Cruz, and one of our local UC professors gave a presentation on what climate change was going to look like here. The redwoods that would die, the buildings that would be underwater, etc. And one of just our local organizers, with no special expertise in process, and I don't think she'd seen it anywhere, she just came up with one of the coolest things I'd ever seen. She had asked in advance four people, who each of whom, after the presentation, stood up separately, one at a time, and said, I'm a single mom, I've got three kids, two jobs, I cannot deal with one more thing. A second person who stood up and said, look, I just need to know a whole lot more, and I don't know who to trust, where to get the right kind of information. A third person stood up in a state of enormous emotional distress, just overwhelmed by this and needing a place to process it. And the fourth person stood up and said, where do I sign up? What do I do? Put me to work. And then people got to go and sit with that person to pursue that question. So I just want to put that out there, because I think it would fit in almost any kind of public conversation that's mixed. Yes, ma'am. Kathleen. Kathleen, you need to unmute.
I would like to talk more with Mike beyond what we can do today about his program. The Network for Peace is a very small organization. We have five people, and we're working on a project, I think, that relates to one of his questions. Is we want to create a paradigm shift from, well, he said stewardship to from domination to relationship. So a lot of what was said today is that it's we're all one. We all came from the same stars. We're all together in how we have developed. So there's a unity about all of us, all of what we do and who we are. And I think that there's been talk about that. We have done, we looked at Laudato Si as a referent for us, and we have done living room dialogues on that. Now, I think he was asking the idea, where do you get the questions? Well, we have five people working together, and we created our own questions. We read it, and we divided the chapters up in three different sections, and we've been working on what we call our Common Ground Project, which has that idea of how can we move, and we're, of course, part of the project, of how can we move from looking, it's not human rights, it's the rights of all, it's the rights of everything that exists to be, so that we have to move from respect and nourishing and celebrating everything that exists, and we're, well, we're on the verge of not doing that very well, obviously. So we have done these living room work dialogue sessions, and we're going into our sixth session. Now, if anyone is interested, the write-ups are all on our website. So the questions, the way we approached it, the responses of the individuals, and what we've learned, and it also, it's beginning, and our conversations to begin to share some of the things that we've also changed, although we really began talking to one another, not by talking. We want, of course, to change our behavior, but we're talking about sharing with one another. So we do have, we talk about stories, we tell a lot of our own stories and how we came to value the things that we value. And that all, if people are interested to see it, and if you go to our website and go to Living Room Dialogues, and the archives are there for the last 2 years. But I would be glad to talk to Mike also encourage him or to share some of the things that we have done. And it's small. It's an initiative, and I guess that's all I say right now. I don't know, Maisha is there. I don't know if she wants to add anything else to that, because Maisha is a part of that conversation with us. And I put her on the spot.
Nancy, you need to unmute again.
Oh, Maisha, please do share with us and unmute yourself.
Hi. So I wanted to add a little bit to what Kathleen said. So we just don't do the living room dialogues. We actually have our own YouTube channel. And what we do is, so I'm reaching out to all of you guys as well. What we do is we interview, but it's not like a serious interview. It's more of a conversation between me and other people who are just interested in Earth or work that has to do with the Earth. And we recently interviewed this person who has her own homestead, so living off the grid, etc. All of this. Should I stop? Oh, okay. All right.
I'm going to finish up. I just need us to move into networking space, but go ahead, Misha.
Oh, okay. I just wanted to say that if any of you guys do want to reach out and have that conversation with me, we record it and we put it up on YouTube, and it's really nice to hear other people's voices when it comes to this. So yeah, that's it. Thank you.
Thank you, all of you. This has been a rich discussion, and we're going to take the last few minutes to do our checking out and networking, and I'm going to turn that back over to Linda, please, to do this with us.
Well, Well, thanks, Nancy. Great job. Great conversation. This was so rich. I can't believe it. I took so many notes, and I can't wait to see Marty's notes, and we did record everything. So let's just can I see a show of hands for people who do have things they want to network? Just let people know about. I'm seeing a few. Okay, so let's incorporate that with just a quick checkout. So if you do have some things, say it when you do your checkout. I don't think there's a whole lot. There's no reason why we need to separate the two. So let's just go around and just do very short checkouts. Anything that really please, you know, we have just a short period of time. And if you have a quick networking thing, go ahead and include that. So, Mike, would you like to lead us off? Mike, you're on mute.
All right. Yeah, if we had four groups, I'd be in that group that I just need a place to process everything. So I do want to follow up with several people on the call about some of the items they discussed. So I'll be doing that. And it was an incredible, very enriching conversation about all of this process that's going on. So thank you very much.
Thank you, Mike. Thanks for being so out there with what you're doing. It was really valuable. Carol, I think I saw you having something to network with too. Carol, you're on mute.
Thank you. As a newcomer, this has been fascinating. And I'm going to send you, Linda, a request to nominate projects that are in the area of emergence that have social impact. And they're looking for a large number of projects to participate in the survey, and then we'll do qualitative research. And from what I've heard here, almost everybody has something that might be valuable, but I don't know how to connect to the whole network. So can I send it to you?
Absolutely. Yeah. That'd be fine.
And the deadline is February 22nd, so somehow it should be insensitive.
Thanks, Carol. I'll get it up on the name.
Great.
Marty?
Yeah, I'm just interested in the next steps on this. I'm intrigued in terms of some of the approach that I use and Ted uses with the TOP methodology and the focus conversation. I think in terms of design principles for some of the study circles, we could plug in on a design level. And I'm also just very intrigued because I think that my group is also working on the two tracks, trying to get lay and ordained people talking more deeply and also trying to have conversations more at the community level. So that's my comment. Thanks all.
Thanks, Marty. Sharon Joy.
Yes, I was, I feel like I'm gulping air with all this information and enthusiasm and taking in breath. Sandy, I want to be sure I can get access to the 10-minute video the astronaut showed. Can you send me that? Because some of you may have read that our friend Edgar Mitchell has passed on since we were on this call. And actually, there is in his legacy this wish for the marriage of science and spirit. And I'll be going over to the celebration next Tuesday for his life and actually next steps about the legacy. So I'm thrilled about that. So that video, I think, is going to be an asset, Sandy. The other piece is maybe the rest of you have some networks of experts that are comfortable with complexity, because that's what I'm experiencing today is a lot of complexity and how might we might be facilitated in that. I also want to let you know that Fletcher Harper from Green Faith was one of the speakers at our interfaith conference a couple of weeks ago. And he said they're doing something on June the 16th. Seems like they want to have green faith circles all over the networks. And I honestly can't give it to you because I can't remember the details, but I will find them and send it to our Ning site. And then I also wanted to let you know that also Matthew Fox was a speaker. And it turns out that his good friend, Bruce Chilton, is the chaplain at Bard College, and you remember, was it Eben Epstein last time was talking about the event they're doing April 16th, I think, and bringing again the science and the spirit together. Maybe that's a word we can think more about. I was hearing that, spirit and values. So thank you.
I'm noticing that we're almost up to the time. If people have to leave, can you show me your hand and I'll try to call on you next? John, why don't you go?
Okay, thanks everybody. Very quick, it's been very rewarding and enriching for me to be here with you. I am about process, about community events, about bringing people together and understanding dialogue and deliberation. So I think one of the a really good topic that we might even want to consider is the idea about dominion and the difference in people's perceptions around that word, bringing in information from the Pope's encyclical, which I posted in our comment section, and other things like that. It seems a very easy to start with type of an idea, putting together a kind of a meeting, a community meeting in a box and getting it out there. So I'll just leave that on the table. I'm available if anybody wants to try to, you know, figure out the logistics for something like that. And then I'm happy to say Leanne and I will be following up also about Earth Charter information. So thanks, everybody. I'm going to have to jump out here real quick. Bye-bye.
Thanks, John. And if anyone has to leave, I totally understand. Thank you so much for participating. Is there anyone that has to leave right away? Okay, I'm going to try to call you. Ted, why don't you go ahead?
Yeah, I just wanted to share, I put in the chat box that ICA will send off to Linda, so she has it to post, the PowerPoint presentation that we referenced earlier that Caitlin did, which intentionally was trying to engage people to appreciate what other faiths were saying about sustainability and climate change. So we had a very rich conversation that not only are here two slides of Pope quotes, but here's other quotes from other faiths. So I think, Michael, you might find that to be of use. Just to reemphasize Marty's point, we are working with our technology of participation trainers to be looking at how they might be doing new focused conversations around different video trailers. So showing a video that was only 2 or 3 minutes, and then what would be the kind of questions you would ask. So as we continue to develop that, I'm sure Marty and I can continue to feed that to Linda to share on the D&D network.
Awesome. Thank you so much. This is the power of networking. I love it. Okay, who else needs to go check out? Kathleen.
I just wanted to ask, I tried to put it on the chat, but I couldn't. Could we have the names and the emails of the people who participated in this dialogue?
Yes, I can send that. I know how to do that. I will do that. Yes.
Thank you.
You're welcome. Thanks, Kathleen. Who else needs to check out right away? Elizabeth, go ahead.
Sorry, I just meant I needed to. I'm not in a hurry if someone else needs to go. Okay, we're okay. I just wanted to say thanks, that I really appreciated all this. It was so helpful, so interesting. The two things that stand out to me as we're leaving is that I just want to hear more. I want to know more about, especially not only the process, but what people hope is the end result, right? We can say like save the planet, but is there anything in between kind of save the planet and our dialogues and what we kind of want that to look like? I'm really curious, both for my own work, my own research, and my own practical work. And the other thing that stood out to me that I think is an important part of our conversation going forward and is important to me to figure out is, we talked a lot about values and a lot about faith, but most people have values, but not everyone has religion or faith. And so just thinking about that, we don't get so bit, you know, that if we only talk about values or just the connectedness of everyone, do we lose something specific to faith communities or religious communities? And how do we talk about something specific without leaving people out, but also realize we can't do everything? So I don't have any answers, but I have just been so thankful to hear what you all are doing, and would love to talk to any of you individually more about your work. If you're interested just in sharing ideas or talking, it's something I'm trying to learn about and get, and it's hard. So thank you.
All right, thanks, Kathleen. I really have the sense that we could go on for quite some time on this topic.
Great questions. by the way.
Yes, yes, I'm very interested in that. Does anybody else need a quick checkout, or shall we just keep going around the circle? Okay, then I'm going to call on Sandy. Sandy, you're on mute.
There we go.
There you go.
Thank you, thank you. This has been very helpful. I've been thinking about how do I sift through all of this soon, but that'll work. I was just looking for it's a YouTube video with the astronauts speaking to the negotiators at COP21. And it's, if you probably search for it, it'll come up pretty easily. They're mostly astronauts on the space station, and not just Americans, but it's, I would recommend it to everyone. So, well, thank you, and I look forward to next month and staying in touch, and I'm going to be here in the trenches.
Thanks, Sandy.
Thanks.
Jason, did you check out? You're on mute.
Hey, yes, just want to say thanks for allowing me to participate. I mostly work with survey data, so it's fun to actually get to listen to like real live people. So this has been fantastic. Thank you.
All right, thanks for joining us. Leanne, did you have some closing comments? You're on mute.
I was desperately looking for the exact dates of Antioch University's East Coast preparedness meeting. I think it's going to be in March in Baltimore. As soon as I find the link, I'll let you know. For those of you who have friends or colleagues here, and this will sound really weird, I won't be able to attend the meeting because of the workload here, but Antioch has, they did this for the New England region. It's 2.5 days split between mostly policy wonks and researchers, and then another one that's oriented specifically for community-based work and educators, and a lot of fascinating people, information, and I don't know that they are considering any faith-based conversations, but at a meeting like this, you can always find people and do a pop-up. So I will get that to Linda and get it in the system so you can see it and send it to your folks on the East Coast. Thank you. And thank you, everyone, anyway. Just quite remarkable conversation.
Thanks, Leanne. Have I missed anyone? Nancy, did you want to have a checkout? You're on mute.
Yeah, I'm feeling just a deep sense of serenity and hope and encouragement and connection that I hadn't been feeling that. I was moving towards it, but that is what is coming to me from this. And it feels so precious. It feels like the grounding for everything else we're doing, and that we can do that for each other and keep doing it. It's the most hopeful thing I know.
Thanks, Nancy. Well, I've been so touched. I could go on, but I won't because we've gone past our time. I just wanted to mention Carol. I'm sorry?
We haven't heard from Carol.
Carol.
No, you did.
We did, yeah.
Okay, sorry.
But thank you.
Is there offered to have people participate in the emergence study?
Is there anybody who needs to check out? I think I've called on everyone.
Don't exclude yourself, please, Linda. We can hang in there for another 2 minutes.
Oh, I'm going to say my piece. I just want to thank everyone for coming. This was marvelous. This was profound. I think we all felt that. So thank you, Nancy, very much for preparing your wonderful agenda. Thank you, Mike, for filling us in on what you're doing. We're going to look forward to hearing more from Russell. We already got a little taste from him. He's going to be our speaker next week, so I can't wait. That's going to be exciting. And then in April, just to give you a little snapshot of what's coming, the hosting team is considering doing the April session on connecting, meaning how can we use networks for social change? And there's a fabulous book that I will be sending out because some of us on the hosting team are reading it. It's got that as its title. I think it's something like Connecting to Change the World. It's not a big book, So it might be something that some of you will want to take a look at. So I'll be getting that out in the notes. And I think that's all I have. So thank you, everyone. This was really wonderful. And I look forward to seeing you all in a month and maybe some of you sooner. So bye-bye. Tuning out.